Hello, everyone. Welcome to this event. Today, I'm going to talk about China, this big country, but still not that well known in Europe, and about its technology sector and what are the potential opportunities for startups from Europe. As said, my name is Max. I'm from Barcelona, but I've been living in Shanghai for over 8 years. I first went there, my first years there, I work in the corporate finance, helping Western big companies in their M&A projects. Then I decided to quit and to start my entrepreneurship life. Since then, I started 2 companies there, 2 startups. The last one, I sold it a few months ago. So recently, I decided to found Sanpei Ventures in order to help Western startups to set foot in China and to accelerate their growth in the region. So China, let's talk about China. How many of you have ever been to China? Could you raise your hand? Wow, okay. Any of you have ever lived in China? Okay, quite a lot. Where, in Shanghai or? Okay. Good, so maybe I should skip this part. No, I'm kidding. So this is China, this is Shanghai, a photo that a lot of people probably are familiar with. The financial center of Shanghai. But this is also China, right? A small village in Hunan province, beautiful, by the way. So there is no thing such as China. There are a lot of Chinas, there are a lot of markets within the country, and this is something that it's important to understand. We all know that China is very big, but in fact, it's a little bit smaller than US in terms of size. It's around twice the size of Europe. And obviously, it's very populated, right? 1,400 million people, 100 million more or less. It's not a big deal. Around almost 3 times the size of Europe and almost 5 times the size of US. So massive country, a lot of people there. But where do these people live? In fact, 94% of the people live in 40% of the territory. So all the left part of China, it's pretty much empty. All the people are condensed in the right side of the country. And even though they only occupy half of the country, 50% of them still live in rural areas, okay? It was 26% of population living in cities in the 90s, now it's 50%, so there has been a great migration, but still, it only accounts for 50%. 3 massive cities, Beijing, Shanghai, Guangzhou, over 20 million people. 7 cities between 10 and 20 million people, and 13 cities between 5 and 10 million, okay? Massive urban areas, very different between them. But as I was saying, still 50% living in the countryside. So in terms of connected users, there are around almost 700 million internet users in China. 90% of them use mobile phones to access internet. So it's a massive penetration rate mobile internet. And out of them, pretty much everyone use social media. Almost 50%, almost half of them use mobile phones to make payments, also really, really big penetration rate. And 45% use their mobile phones to buy online. So these are percentages, these are penetration rates that are much higher than most of the developed countries. To show that China, Chinese users are really tech savvy and are really early adopters. Just a couple more of facts, nearly 200 million online to offline users, meaning that during their customer journey, they will interact both online and offline, and 74 million machine-to-machine connections, connected devices, what we know as Internet of Things, making it obviously the largest market in the world. So we know that China is very big. We know that there is a lot of people in China. We know that these people are quite tech savvy and well connected. But how did we get there? It followed a very similar path than other countries, right? It all started what now they call Web 1.0. Back then, I don't know how they call it, but in the late 90s, Chinese startups saw what was going on in US and basically replicate the same concept, the same models, right? We're talking here about search engines. We're talking about email providers. We're talking about news media portals, etc., right? These Chinese companies were basically copycats of whatever was being done in US. But they built the basic infrastructure for the next wave, which was Web 2.0. This Web 2.0 that happened in the late 2000s, they were still strongly inspired by what was happening in US, but already localizing, already thinking about the Chinese users and adapting to their local tastes, right? And these Web 2.0 companies, what they did is to set the path to innovation, and this is what we're seeing now. What we're seeing now in China are truly innovative startups that are launching products that are not inspired by their counterparts in US, and it's something that needs to be highlighted and that everyone should be aware of, right? I'm gonna give five different examples about companies in the technology sector in China, okay? Big companies, some of them are Chinese, some of them are internationals, so we can learn a little bit some lessons in following their path. The first one is Alibaba. I'm sure everyone knows about Alibaba, right? Probably the most famous and the largest tech company in China. I'm sure that most of you know this guy, Jack Ma. Maybe not the best looking guy in the world, but for sure, a truly remarkable entrepreneur, one of the greatest entrepreneurs of our time. So Jack Ma started Alibaba.com in 1998 as a B2B portal connecting Chinese suppliers with overseas buyers. Back then, China was the factory of the world, but he wanted to offer this opportunity to these mid-sized suppliers to be able to access the international market, right? He had no idea about internet. Internet was something very new in China, but he found this way, no, to create some innovation already back then. Then in 2003, they set up Taobao. Taobao is a C2C marketplace for Chinese market, right? Back then, when Taobao was launched, there was a dominant player in the market that had around 90% of the market share. That player was Itchnet, that had been recently acquired by eBay. Back then, eBay was a very big internet player. Nowadays, it's not that relevant. What eBay decided is, because they acquired this company that had dominance of the market, that they should mimic what they were doing in US. So that company should have the same interface as eBay and very similar functionality, right? At the same time, the guys at Taobao, what they realized is that the e-commerce market was very new in China. People that were buying online for the first time, they didn't have a lot of trust, a lot of confidence. So what they did is they introduced two unique features. The first one is the review system, which nowadays sounds very basic, but back then it was not. So users could review their products, the products that they bought. So as a new user goes there, sees what other buyers think, and then decides whether he trusts the buyer or not. And the second one would be a payment escrow system. So if I'm a buyer and I wanted to buy a product, I would pay, and then Taobao would hold the payment until I receive the product and I confirm that the product is okay. So these two things, along with other actions that they implemented, made that in 3 years, they went from zero to being the clear dominant of the market, to the point that eBay ended exiting the market. So as part of this, as I said, in 2004, they created Alipay to have their own payment system. Now it's the dominant payment system in China. 2008, they launched Tmall.com, which is a B2C marketplace. Instead of end users selling their products, it's all the big brands have stores there and sell directly to the customers. Apple, Microsoft, Zara, Nike, all the big brands are selling in China through Tmall. And as we all know, in 2015, they launched the largest tech IPO in history in New York Stock Exchange. So in less than 20 years from setting up a B2B portal for suppliers to the largest tech IPO in history. So what did we learn about this? First, timing to market. They started with a B2B model, then they adopted a C2C model, and they moved to a B2C model, right? Understanding what is the right timing and when the market is mature for each of the different products. Also, the importance of understanding the local needs, right? eBay had all the market share. eBay was a huge company back then. Taobao was little, but they were able to conquer the market by understanding what were the local needs. Also, we learned that localization can lead to innovation. So basically understanding these needs and creating solutions for these needs made them innovate and create Alipay, which is a massive payment system nowadays. Also, what we learned is that both the user education and the product development need to go hand by hand, especially in new sectors. Timing is very important, so you need to educate your customers and you need to launch your products at the same time. And that is not enough. In order to grow, and in order to grow in China, you need to keep adding functionality to it, to add value to the users, and also to increase engagement. So this is what Alibaba has been doing since then. In terms of e-commerce and B2C verticals, besides Tmall, they have group buying, Zhuhuashan, they have flash sales, May.com, which actually was founded by a French guy in Shanghai and sold to Alibaba a few months ago. It's one of the few B2C success case from foreigners in China, quite remarkable. Didi, taxi booking and car hailing, online travel, online financial service, which is called Ant Financial. They recently raised a round, and their valuation was larger than UBS, the Swiss bank, right? So this gives you an idea of the massive size of the market, and AliHealth, that are online health service. Not only they focus on growing in e-commerce, but also on entertainment. So Alibaba dominates Youku, which is the equivalent of YouTube in China, Weibo, which would be it's so-called the Twitter in China, Xiaomi, which is online streaming music. They recently acquired South China Morning Post, the largest newspaper in Hong Kong. And they also acquire UC Browser, about browser and gaming. Not only platforms, but also developing their own content. They said a while ago, Alibaba Pictures, that produce movies in China, but also in US. They invested in Guangzhou Evergrande, which is the best football team in Asia. They won the Asia Champions League recently. And there are rumors, I don't know if it's confirmed, that they are gonna acquire AC Milan. So they are coming to Europe and they are coming quite strong. Also, obviously, they built infrastructure for all their merchants, cloud, Aliyun, payment solutions. They developed the largest ad network in China. They acquire AutoNavi, which is the largest mapping solution provider in China. And they obviously, as a proper e-commerce platform, they developed their own logistics systems, Cainiao, and they invested in Singapore Post. And now China is not enough for them. So they recently acquired from Rocket Internet Lazada, the largest e-commerce marketplace in Southeast Asia. They invested in Snapdeal, one of the largest players in India, also in e-commerce. Jet.com and Groupon in US. They invested in Snapchat and Lyft, also in US. And in China, they are also expanding into other sectors, into more traditional sectors. Meizu, which is a smartphone manufacturer, Haier, which is one of the largest appliance manufacturer, and even Suning, which is an appliance retailer similar to what Media Market is in Europe. So as you see, from B2B portal to having presence in pretty much all the sectors in China and expanding beyond in less than 20 years. Now, let's talk about Tencent, also a very popular Chinese technology company, also very big. Tencent started in China in the 98 as well with QQ Messenger, which basically it was a pure copycat of ICQ. Windows Messenger, AOL Messenger, basic concept, right? Obviously, they acquire a massive user base in China pretty fast. And then in 2004, they launched, they started developing games, okay? Online games, multiplayer games, simple games, but highly addictive, with a freemium model. So it was for free, but then they would start generating revenue by selling virtual products. 2008, they launched Qzone, which is a social network that is a mix between the typical network, blogging, document sharing. It reached around 700 million users at its peak. It became the largest social network in the world. And what it's remarkable is that users were extremely active. They would spend hours and hours every day on this network. So back in 2008, Tencent already had a massive user base, really active users, and they had a way to monetize that, which is something quite unique. Usually, Western counterparts, they might have similar user base, but they are making zero money, right? And then in 2011, they launched WeChat, which is their most popular product and the best product to date. So WeChat, when WeChat was launched, it would be called the WhatsApp of China, right? Even the logos are quite similar, let's be honest. Obviously, the main function was chat, was messaging, but since the beginning, Tencent add more features, okay? They add Moments, which is kind of like the Facebook timeline, so you can see your context wherever that they post. They launched the People Nearby function, which basically you would shake your phone and then you would meet people around you that were shaking the phone at the same time. Could be a bit creepy, but it was popular. They also launched the walkie-talkie function, which, I mean, typing in Chinese sometimes can be a bit more difficult, a bit slower than Latin languages. So basically, you could hold and then you could give short message, and then you could have a conversation with your contacts via audio. They also launched the QR code function. So if you wanted to add one contact, you would scan the QR code. And probably this set up the basis for what is now. QR codes are not that popular in the West, but in China, they are massively used. And later, they launched also a desktop app, group chat, video call. Some of these features were later implemented by WhatsApp, right? So what it started as a pure copy, later it got as a reference for WhatsApp. These functionalities are very important in China for two reasons. The first reason is that it adds value to the users, okay? When WeChat was starting in China, you would ask people in China why they were using WeChat and not WhatsApp, right? I mean, it's a very simple interface, so language is not a problem. WhatsApp was not blocked by Chinese government, never. So what they would reply is that WhatsApp is boring. It's you can only chat with it, right? Whereas in WeChat, you can do much more things, right? So it has much more value for the users. And the second point why these features are important is because it adds ways to monetization. Basically, I think this is one thing that Chinese startups are doing much better since the beginning than Western ones, is how to monetize apps, right? WhatsApp, it was acquired by Facebook. Of course, it's different, but they never monetize, and they've been online for many years, and still they are not making any money. Besides that, nowadays, WeChat became probably the most important tool for daily use in China. Besides talking with your friends, you can book taxis through the app. You don't need to go to another app. You can not only make payments in restaurants or in stores, but also transfer money to your friends. You can buy movie tickets. You can buy plane tickets, train tickets. You can pay your water or electricity bills. You can get discounts based on your location. You can appoint a doctor visit. You can manage your finance. You can meet people. You can track your health. And even you can give money to charity. So everything from a single app without leaving the app. What it's remarkable about WeChat is that they've been able to build a true mobile platform, okay? And now any business can integrate to WeChat, so it's a great way to generate, to monetize the platform, and it became even a reference for Facebook or for WhatsApp in order to further strategy path in the West. Now I'm going to talk about Xiaomi. I don't know if you are familiar with Xiaomi. It's not that popular in Europe. They don't have a lot of presence here. Xiaomi is a smartphone manufacturer. Okay, when it was launched in 2011, people say that it was basically a low-cost copy of Apple. And in fact, their whole image and design has a lot of resemblance, right? Even their founder, Lei Jun, got massively criticized in the tech press because their keynotes were very, very similar to those of Steve Jobs, right? So nowadays, Xiaomi has a valuation of $45 billion. It's one of the largest unicorns in the world. It's been named one of the smartest companies in the world by MIT Review. It's been named one of the most innovative companies by Fast Company. So how did they get there? Obviously not by making cheap smartphones, right? There is much more than that. What they did is first they launched a smart band like Fitbit, to track your health and your movements. Also they launched some integrated cameras, they launched some smart light bulbs, they launched some scales, also smart of course, air purifiers, which is something that it's quite important in China given the levels of pollution in big cities. They launched some kind of small version of Segway, which actually I see it around there. Basically they acquire Segway, so later they add the product to the market. Smart TVs, and even rice cookers, which is quite important in China, actually. So basically what they did is they moved from being a cheap smartphone manufacturer to build a platform, to build an ecosystem, right? To the point that nowadays they are the first true IoT company in the world, okay? Through your Xiaomi smartphone, because you can use their app with another smartphones, you can control pretty much everything. So it's very remarkable that in just in less than 5 years of time, they moved from making cheap but nice looking smartphones to becoming to creating this ecosystem for connected devices, for smart homes, and becoming a true Internet of Things company. Okay, so now let's talk about Uber, okay? Uber, everyone knows about Uber, right? They invented this whole business model, and they are in China as well, okay? But they were not the first to access Chinese market. In 2012, there were two startups, Kuaidi Dache and Didi Dache, that launched these apps to book taxis. If you have been to China, you know that in big cities, in rush hours, it's almost impossible to get a taxi. So they created this app for which you could identify the taxis that are around, book them, they would give you a ride, and then you would pay through the app, right? Both of them started gaining some traction in 2012, and obviously they got back up by Tencent and by Alibaba, like pretty much all the startups in China. But then something unique happened. In 2013, Uber decided to come to China with an initial investment of $1 billion US dollars. So, of course, I mean, these startups were backed up by Tencent or Alibaba, but they were still small companies compared to Uber. They were a bit scared. And on top of that, Uber was coming to China with a different model. These startups were taxi booking apps. So Uber decided to come with car hailing directly, private drivers, same model that they develop in US, which was a very aggressive move because this is a sector that was a gray area in China. It's unregulated, so they were very bold in just going, tapping the market directly through private drivers. Of course, Didi and Kwaidi immediately also start offering car ride through private drivers, which was a great move for them because now they account around for 50% of the revenue. But still, this was not enough to stop Uber. I mean, Uber is a huge company. So in 2015, Kwaidi and Didi they decided to merge to create one company, which is a very unique situation. The fact that Tencent and Alibaba decide to work together on something, it's like when the Berlin Wall, you know, was finished and US and Russia decided to talk again. So they created this company, a massive company, in order to compete with Uber, right? Not only that, but last month they reached a strategic agreement with Lyft, so they can work together and leverage their respective platforms in all the different countries in the world. And not only that, but just 30 minutes ago, I just read that Apple decided to invest $1 billion US dollars into Didi. Okay, so this makes this car hailing industry in China even more exciting. Still, there are no news about what it's gonna go next, but it's very, very exciting. So, Can Uber win this battle? Right now, Uber is investing $1 billion US dollars every year. They are burning this money into the market, and they only have between 20 and 30% of market share, okay? Uber would say 30%, the rest would say 20, no one knows. But honestly, it's difficult. It's difficult for them. They enter the market very aggressively, as I mentioned before. So it's a sector that it's still unregulated. There are uncertainties whether if the Chinese government decides to regulate that sector, what would be the position of Uber, right? Uber is a huge company, but still they are competing with Tencent and Alibaba, and they are competing with them working together. So compared to them, they are peanuts. I don't know if they will be able to survive. Also, another problem is Uber has multiple focus, right? They are in several markets, in a lot of big markets. They are very aggressive in accessing new markets, whereas Didi is only focused on China. This is obviously an advantage for them. And also, the last point is Uber built everything from scratch. They access China and they start adding users. And Didi has been leveraging the massive user base of Tencent and Alibaba combined. So are they gonna win this battle? I have no idea, no one knows, but it's a very interesting case to follow up over the next month. So the last company that we're gonna see is Apple Pay. Apple is very unique, and one of the nice things about Apple Pay is that every time that they access a market, they become the market leader within hours, okay? Because there are no competitors and the adoption rate is really, really high. In China, it's not like this. Apple Pay access Chinese market a couple of months ago. And when they access, they already had there was already a massive user base using mobile payments. Just to give you an idea of the size of the sector when they access, the quarterly transactions through mobile payments was around $3.8 trillion. Okay, so it's not a new sector. It's a sector that has been going on in China for a while already. It has a 70% penetration rate in urban cities. And to give a very clear example, McDonald's, that has a massive deployment in China, recently they receive more payments through mobile in their outlets than with cash and cards combined. So the adoption has been massive, and it's already a mature market. Alibaba has around 70% of the market, WeChat has around 30%, Apple Pay, we don't know yet. So same, can Apple Pay win this battle? In this case, the situation is a little bit different. First, because Apple Pay is using NFC technology, which is somehow better than the technologies used by Alipay and by Tencent. It's faster. You don't need to open the app to make the payment. And it can work offline. Alipay and Tencent, what they use is basically you need to open the app, you need to generate a QR code, and then the merchant will scan the QR code, and then the payment is done, right? So the process is more smooth with Alipay, and it's faster. Also, another advantage is that Alipay partner with all the local banks in China, and also with UnionPay, that it's a Visa or MasterCard of China. All the banks were a bit scared about Tencent and Alibaba because they are becoming banks themselves, right? And they are taking away all their business. So when they saw that Apple Pay was accessing China, they saw an opportunity and then joined forces. This shows us the importance of having a local partner in China. Uber, even though it's backed up by Baidu, it's going pretty much solo. Apple Pay is going hand by hand with the banks and UnionPay. On the other hand, why it's going to be difficult for Apple to succeed? First, it's already a consolidated market. Tencent and Alibaba backing it up like pretty much in any sector lately. What we mentioned before about functionality, Apple Pay is great to make payments. It's really convenient, but you can only make payments. Whereas when you use Alipay or you use WeChat Pay, You can transfer money to your friends, you can receive money, of course, you can share your bill when you go to a restaurant, so it has much more functionalities. And also, same as Uber, competing with the user base, the massive user base of Tencent and Alipay, it's not easy, right? But again, very interesting to see how it evolves. So in terms of opportunities, as I said, there is a lot of innovation in China right now, and all the hot sectors that are hot in US or in Europe are also in China. Artificial intelligence and deep learning is one of the obviously most important sectors. Just to put a couple of quick examples, Alibaba is developing a technology, a face recognition technology, for which when you want to make a mobile payment, they will scan your face and then will verify your identity. So it's a very practical example on how you can leverage deep learning, in this case, face recognition. Another example is, I don't know if you saw in the news that recently Google Deep Blue just beat the Go champion. Go is a kind of a chess invented by Chinese. Obviously this didn't, you know, Chinese people didn't like that. And there are rumors saying now that at the end of the year, Chinese technology companies want to challenge American companies in a Go game to see who has the better technology. For sure, it will be really interesting, right? See who wins. Another very hot sector is augmented reality and virtual reality, of course. There are really solid players in the market in China already. China has not only very good knowledge of software, but they are really good in hardware. They have all the manufacturing experience. And in the south of China, in Shenzhen, actually it's becoming one of the hardware hubs of the world. Smart cities and Internet of Things. We saw the example of Xiaomi as the first true IoT company. A lot of opportunities there. Early adopter users, connected users, so really easy for them to embrace these new technologies. And smart cities, we've seen massive urban areas, a lot of problems in terms of mobility, a lot of problems from the governments to manage the cities in an efficient way. So also really, really large demand in terms of technologies that can apply to smart cities. Big data and business intelligence, of course. I mean, there is no much to add here. And today, nowadays, anyone needs that. MedTech and health, also very important. We're talking about massive population. It's an aging population, plus with the one-child policy. We've seen the news about the pollution levels in China, plus there is a growing disposable income by Chinese citizens. So they want to, they pay more attention to health, right? So any technology that taps in health or medical, it's quite relevant in China. And obviously, ad tech and digital marketing. China is the largest retail market in the world already. E-commerce has a very big penetration rate. We saw smartphones also having a very big penetration rate. Early adopter consumers, very tech savvy, so there are a lot of opportunities in this field as well. At the end, what is the uniqueness about China? It's the combination of early adoption, so tech savvy users, early adopter users, and scalability, massive user base. So any new solution, if it succeeds, can scale up really, really fast. Of course, there are some sectors where there are opportunities, but these are some that we identify and that are very, very hot in China right now. Also, a couple of things to take into consideration. First, there is a very fast-growing M&A activity in China. Okay, Chinese companies are very active investing or acquiring other companies, both in China but also overseas. Just to put an example, BAT, which stands for Baidu, Alibaba, and Tencent, the three biggest players, they are expected to spend around $90 billion this year only in investment and acquisitions. So it's a very relevant figure. But then it's not all about the big players. There are a lot of mid-sized companies in China that they are growing really fast, that they are doing amazing things, and they are also interested in investing or in acquiring a lot of foreign companies. So this is something to be considered as well. And also, I want to mention Internet Plus. Internet Plus is a policy released by Chinese government that puts innovation as one of the top priorities for China. They want to. Their goal is to improve productivity using technology. So they are releasing a lot of policies that are very friendly towards innovation, towards technology. So this is also another thing that needs to be considered when thinking about China and being a technology company, of course. So what are the conclusions that we can reach? First, we've seen the evolution of Chinese technology sector, right? From being a pure copycat model to being a place where innovation is fostered and where new technologies and new solutions are developed and are implemented in a really, really fast way. We also learned that execution is king, okay? You need to localize the product. You need to understand what are the uniqueness of the country, and then you need to be able to adapt. Otherwise, it's impossible to succeed. No matter how big you are, no matter how good is your name, it's all about execution in China. Another thing is about thinking your business model. What works in the West might not work in China.
again, understand the country, understand the needs, and then if it's necessary, just adapt the business model to China, right? We also saw about how important are the ecosystems and the functionality in China. We've seen the ecosystems that Alibaba created, that Tencent created, that Xiaomi created. So when accessing China, think how you can leverage these ecosystems, right? It makes more sense, for example, if you want to launch an app, to try to integrate with WeChat and tap in their massive user base rather than launch it from scratch and then burning millions and millions in user acquisition. And functionality. The trend in the West is simplicity. The trend in China is value. So again, think twice about your main features and the value that you're offering to the customers. Also, we saw about early adoption and scalability, right? Tech-savvy early adopter users. It's impressive to see how quickly a new solution is deployed and it gains traction in China, and then the massive scale of the country, right? Probably the only country that could be compared is US, but still it's much, much smaller. So especially coming from Europe, think big about China. The scale of the country and its user base is just massive. Also, the importance to have local partners that can help you to tap the market. We've seen it with Apple, which is one of the largest companies in the world, right? A local player can help you to develop the strategy, to understand the market. A local player can help you to leverage their existing network and navigate the waters. Of course, you need to choose the player, the partner carefully, but it's something that's worth considering. And be aware of the cultural differences and all the regulations. China is a different country, so adapt to their culture and don't expect that they do it the other way around. And be aware of the regulations, the obvious regulations and the ones that are a little bit hidden, okay? Europe is very transparent in terms of regulations. China is not that much, so it's something that also needs to be considered. So that is all. Thank you, Xie. And I hope that you enjoy it and that you learn something today. Thank you. So, yeah, questions? Yeah.
I've got a question. You were talking about the fact of choosing a local partner. Mm-hmm. I'm in this situation now, and I'm wondering, so first, how you choose them, how you trust them, and how you enforce your contracts with them. Like, do you base your contracts in Hong Kong so that you can actually enforce them, or you go visit Shanghai, a business court, and you hope for the best if in case of problems?
Okay, so the first was how you find them, right? Or of course, you need to have some knowledge about China, right? Nowadays, there are a lot of ways to go to China, no? How you trust them? There is no thumb rule for that. It's about checking the reputation. It's about seeing if there is feeling, right? And then it's about trust them, but also be aware, not be protective with your business, and then this goes to the third part. I'm not an expert in I'm not a legal expert, but then based on my experience, no, you need to reinforce from a legal perspective everything in China, because Hong Kong is, I mean, it's not really China in this aspect. It's good to have some structure in Hong Kong, but at the end, if you're gonna operate in China, you need to be in China, right? In terms of legal advice, I can recommend you some lawyers if you want, but try to keep some cards for you, okay? Don't show all your cards and then try to make your position always strong with a partner. That would be my advice.
Just two quick questions.
Sure.
First, I know there is a Chinese word, I don't remember which one, that speak about relationship networks.
Yeah.
Networking. So I would like to speak about this because you didn't speak at all about it. It's important.
Guangxi, yeah.
And the second point is NDA. I had a lot of discussion with a lot of lawyers everywhere. They say to forget the NDAs, they don't care. They're also the non-circumventions and the 5NC, whatever.
Yeah.
Look, with local courts, could you tell a little about it, please?
Yeah. Well, yeah, Guangxi, no, this term for relationships is very important in China. I didn't talk about it because I think that everyone already talks about this, right? By saying to have local partners, I somehow imply, no, that it's important to have relationships at China level. About your second comment, NDA. An NDA is useless in China, or at least an NDA written in Europe is useless in China. There are ways to protect yourself, but yeah, again, from a legal perspective, you can be protected in China, but then you need Chinese lawyers, and then you need to write everything according to Chinese law, right? Anything that comes from Europe is useless. Yeah, exactly. Local agreements based on Chinese law, and the second thing is what I said. Even though you can be legally protected, just try to keep some of the cars to yourself, right? If it's technology wise, I mean, I don't know, keep your source code. If it's business, I don't know, make yourself necessary at all times. That would be my advice.
Hello, I'm Alice from Dojo Group. First of all, thank you very much for your presentation. Can you tell us a bit more about your work and maybe some examples of startups you've helped?
Sure. As I said, first, I let me tell you a little bit my background, so then you will understand. I started my first startup in 2011. It was related to retail, helping mid-size foreign brands in fashion and lifestyle to expand in China by using technologies. Okay. While I was doing that, I became very interested in omnichannel, in trying to link online and offline. So that's how I developed my second startup. Actually, this startup, I didn't create the startup. This was a startup that was created in Barcelona. What I did is partner with them. So we set up a joint venture in China. They would provide the technology and I would allocate all the resources to operate it. So then we set up the company, I developed the market, we start gaining traction really fast, signing big clients, becoming a very relevant player in the market. And then a few months ago, we received an investment, Series A investment by SoftBank. And then at that time, what I did is I sold my equity at China level back to the startup. So when I decided to create Sanpei Ventures, the idea was to replicate a similar model, right? And identify startups that we think have potential in China. It has to be technology-based, ideally B2B, and then either partner with them to develop their operations in China or offer them some basic support so they can set up their first steps in China. So Sanpei Ventures was created just a few months ago. We're starting now the operations. We have the first partnership signed now. I cannot disclose the name yet, but the goal is to keep adding more startups that want to access the market.
Hello, I'm Sebastian. Talking about the startups, I think like lately there's a lot of interest for it, and I've been told that there are also incubators there, and a lot of Chinese people are following some trainings and stuff. Yeah. Do you still think for Western ideas there's room and opportunities?
Well, I think that there are always opportunities, right? If you want to access China, you need to be very realistic. Realize whether you have something unique that can be competitive in the market, right? If you want to access China with innovation based on business model, B2C, it's gonna be extremely difficult, right? Because once you tap in the market, you start developing what prevents others to copy you, others that have much more knowledge of the market and much more resources. There are a lot of incubators and accelerators, but they are focusing on very early stage companies. And and I'm not sure. I'm not sure that an incubator type of startup can really succeed in China nowadays. Some of them will, but the chances are really low. What we are focusing is on mostly B2B, because we think it's easier to grow in China with a B2B model. We focus on technology, so you offer some uniqueness, you offer some innovation through technology, and then we think that the startup needs to have already a decent size in order to be able to access Chinese market, right? So this would be the uniqueness of our value proposition against some of the accelerators that are there in the market now.
Okay, thank you. And just the other way around, I was told that Jack Ma is in France right now. Do you have any ideas of why? Is he investing in the Western countries?
Well, I didn't know that he was in France, and he's not my friend.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I know that he's investing a lot in Europe. Not only for Alibaba, but also personally. I know that he acquired a chateau in France and a winery. I know that he likes Italy very much as well. So, yeah, probably he will be buying something. I don't know what. Yeah, if I know, I will let you know.
Hello, my name is Christine. I'm a lawyer based in Beijing. I can give you an information about Jack Ma. He's receiving the Legion d'honneur from Laurent Fabius these days, and also they are investing in Europe to develop different locations for e-commerce purpose. So to develop in Europe e-commerce platforms. To come back also to the questions you raised from a legal perspective in China, I totally agree with what you said, and there is also something very important is to protect intellectual property very, very early when you have a project with China, when you start to go to China to see if there are some potential interest in your project. Really, really protect your trademark and everything very early in the process. Do not start to distribute some business cards with some names on it without a proper protection in China, not only in Europe. It's not enough. You need to have protection in China.
I've got a question for you. Do you do product registrations in cosmetics?
Yes, we do. You need as you seem to be aware of it, if you want to distribute cosmetics in China, you need a license to do it. And yes, sure, we can do it.
So yeah, obviously IP is extremely important in China. I'm not a lawyer, but I think that you mentioned a lot about trademark, brands, etc. Right? In terms of pure technology, we're talking about source code, etc. It's a bit more tricky. Back to the NDA.
On your presentation, you were focusing more on B2C businesses. Uh-huh. Can you tell us about B2B businesses and the difficulty to set up a business in?
Well, I focus more on B2C because at the end you need the C, right? You need the consumers. For me personally, I'm an advocate of B2B in China. I think it makes much more sense and it's more realistic to grow. I think that the final conclusions, the final advice would apply also for B2B, which is have a local partner if it's possible. Try to develop a network so you can grow your business through channel partners, similar that you would do in Europe, and try to think whether your business model works in China, even if it's B2B, right? For example, SaaS, it's something that it's mainstream everywhere. In China, it's getting there, but it's still a bit more complicated, right? So this is just a simple example. Understand what is the uniqueness of China, understand what is the potential, and then adapt your business model as well.
Great.
OK,
Can you tell us more about what you did in omni-channel retail?
You mean the startup?
Yeah, previous startup.
Sure, yeah. Free advertising, it never hurts. The startup is called Bia Blue. What Bia Blue does is Bia Blue, B-E-A-B-L-O-O. What it does is analytics and digital marketing for physical spaces. So similar as Google Analytics tells you the information about your visitors in your website, Bia Blue does it for brick and mortar stores, understanding people that pass in front of the store, how many of them go inside, how do they move around. Yeah, that's correct. Back then in 2013 was something quite new. Now I know it's more mainstream, but the uniqueness of Bia Blue is that it takes all this information and then it leverages it to personalize the communication at the point of sale. So you can reach several touch points at the point of sale. You can personalize the communication via screens in the store or via app or via the Wi-Fi login portal. So
we have like customers coming by, and we have like a loyalty program with us. How do you connect with your data and the loyalty program?
Well, Bia Blue solution is more focused on anonymous data. So okay, in this case, it's more about big data, about trends, understanding the profiling, and then pushing communication. But what you say, it's doable as well. It's about identifying that user with a unique ID and then matching it.
Right.
So yeah, it can be possible, but from a legal point of view, it's a bit
fishy.
More tricky. Yeah. Okay, so well, thank you very much. I hope that you enjoy it, and yeah, you have my contact here if you need. Good luck on it.